Shalom, everybody out there. It's another new moon time, end of the month, seventh month, which is the holiest, probably the holiest month on the calendar, the Hebrew calendar. What is it called? Tishri? And, excuse me. It's good to be on back on with you again, even though some things in this world are not going well. We do have the assurance that with Yah, Yah's in control, all right? We have the assurance that Yah is in control of all things. And, you know, I have to admit, I got some bad news not too long ago. Concerning my mother. Not that she's passed away, but she's in not good a condition, put it that way. And this has been a concern of mine for the last few years. But Yah has blessed her to hold on in there and to stay awake and to stay with us until now. We don't know what's going to happen in the future, but we trust God, you know, that He's in control. My mother's a godly woman, a woman of God, a child of God, you know, and may not have been the most perfect. But which one of his children are really perfect? But yeah, so I've been kind of, have to admit, kind of down a little bit about what's going on there. But, you know, we put that in God's hand. But this is the seventh month, the end of the seventh month. We're going to go into the eighth month on the Hebrew calendar. And tomorrow is the new moon day, I believe, right? New moon day, all right? And like I said, many people have different calendars. And we have studied this calendar. You know, I don't know about the Jubilee calendar, the Enoch calendar. There's some different calendars out there, I'm telling you. What I did, I just went by the Mosaic calendar, you know, that came out of Egypt. Came out of Egypt on the, you know, Passover. The next day after Passover, which is the next day after Passover is a holy day, is a Sabbath, a Shabbat, which is the Feast of Unleavened Bread. Excuse me, but it says he brought them out at night. I think he said that. Let me see. Let's check this out. Because he came out of Egypt at night. Let's see here. Am I in the right book? Let's see. I might have to search the scripture out. the money. Okay. So it's Deuteronomy 16:1. Observe the month of Abib and keep the Passover in the month. Keep the Passover unto Yahweh the Elohim, for in the month of Abib, Yahweh the Elohim brought thee forth out of Egypt by night. All right. So they kept the Passover. And the next day was the Feast of Unleavened Bread. He did all that Passover meal and sacrifice and everything. And the death happened at night of Passover, which is Abib 14. All right, the 14th day of Abib. The next day is the 15th day of Abib. And that's a Sabbath, Shabbat. So you can't do nothing on that day. So what happened was, I think that's when Pharaoh called Moses and told him to get out. And Moses and his people waited until night and left. All right. And that right there should tell you something too. When you study the Bible, it should tell you that the Sabbath day is a day. All right. The Sabbath day is a day. All right. It's not a night. It's not a Sabbath night. That's the reason why when people say to keep the Sabbath, it begins in the evening. All right. It begins in the evening, and then you go to bed and you wake up and it's a daytime, and you wait until the evening, and then it's over with. All right. That's why it's hard for me to get my understanding around it. It says right here, observe the month of Abib and keep the Passover in the unto Yahweh the Elohim. For in the month of Abib, Yahweh the Elohim brought thee forth out of Egypt by night. Let me highlight this. Brought him forth by night. And for those that believe that the Sabbath starts at night, when did he bring Israel out of Egypt? What night was it? Was it the night of Passover? Because obviously it couldn't have been the night of Passover because they were not supposed to go out, right? So if they waited, all right, they waited. I guess you can find a way to get around this, no matter what you believe. But the next day, the next night, would have been the 15th, which is a Shabbat. Did he bring him out on the Shabbat? All right. But he brought him out by night. Okay. But anyway, that's a heck of a study. But I keep what I learned my calendar through the Mosaic scriptures from the Genesis to Deuteronomy. All right. That's how I learned it. And the holy days, the holy weeks, like the Feast of Unleavened Bread on the first month, starting when the moon is full. All right, the moon is always full at Passover. It's always full in the seventh month, and you keep the month of Sukkot. You started on the 15th of each month, the full moon. All right. And you notice that the calendar seems to be the same every month, that the 15th of every month on the calendar is a full moon. All right. But we won't go further on that, because that's a whole other ball game, a whole other study. Okay. But anyway, as we've been studying, we've been talking about Yahweh Elohim. All right. Yahweh Elohim. And he, there's the major scripture, the major law in the Bible. Is Yahweh Elohim. Right here it says the Lord thy God. All right. But in Hebrews, Yahweh Elohim. Yahweh Elohim. All right. He's the major law. What's the major law? You shall love Yahweh. No, no, it's a Shema. Hear, O Israel, Yahweh Elohim is one Yahweh. Thou shalt love Yahweh the Elohim with all thy heart, mind, soul, body, and strength. And the second commandment is likened to it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself, Yahweh Shai said. Upon these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Loving Yahweh Elohim and loving our neighbor as thyself. And ten commandments are like that. The first four of the ten commandments is loving Yahweh Elohim. Those are commandments about loving him. And the second, the last six of the ten commandments is loving our neighbor as thyself. You know? You shall honor thy father and thy mother, shall not steal, shall not kill, shall not bear false witness, you know, all of those commandments. It has something to do with loving your neighbor. Okay? But we've been talking about something that we don't understand a whole lot, especially in the churches. Who is Yahweh Elohim, and what does he have to do with the kingdom? Is he going to show up? We talk about Yahweh Shai, all right, which is Jesus Christ. And many in the church, I think, you know, you just sit down and you listen to many of the Bible studies on TBN and any Christian network, and everybody's waiting on Jesus Christ. And I understand that. He said he was coming back, didn't he? All right. I think he said that he was, there was going to be a return of him. All right. And I used to teach that Jesus Christ was this Yahweh Elohim. But I don't teach that anymore because I found out something different. Okay. It's not that Jesus Christ is not important. He is very important. He's the Lamb of God. You know? And, as we can see in Revelation chapter 7, when you see that there's a whole multitude of people with white robes on and palm branches in their hand, all right? And one of the angels asks John, what are these arrayed in white robes? You know, he says, sir, thou knowest. And these are they that came out of great tribulation and washed their robes, made them white in the blood of the Lamb. All right? And before that, they stood before these people that's in these white robes with palm branches, stood before the throne and before the Lamb and said, salvation unto the one that sits on the throne, salvation to him, the one that sits on the throne, which is Yahweh Elohim, and unto the Lamb. All right? All right? So, I had to reassess that. That the first one that they talked about, salvation being unto, is the one that sits on the throne. Who sits on the throne in heaven? This person right here. Did the Lamb sit on the throne? No, the Lamb is right beside the throne. But he didn't sit on the throne. All right? But this is the Creator right here. Yahweh Elohim. All right? And it's really it's a good study because Yahweh Elohim should be the most important thing to us. This is the major commandment, right? And I'm finding it a good study, a heck of a study. All right? Now, most of the people I see, especially the Gentiles, are talking about Christianity. They're saying that Jesus is the one that sits on the throne. And I used to say it too. But no, it's not Jesus that sits on the throne because Jesus is praying unto this Yahweh Elohim in John chapter 17. And when he taught his disciples how to pray, he taught them that to pray unto his Father, his God and Father that's in heaven. All right. When he was on the cross, he said, my God, why has thou forsaken me? All right. So there's something different going on there. This person right here is the God of Israel. Is Yahweh Shai Mashiach the God of Israel? Not necessarily so. All right? And we're going to continue to talk about this because this is the major commandment. This is this is what Israel should be doing. Now, I look at Israel as, let me see. Israel is a people that's a lost sheep, okay? And it's easy to spot them in the world. There are people that have an ethnicity, but have no land. They have no identity as a people. And every few years, they're given a new identity. Maybe something if you was to call them Jews, then you would say those are the Jews. But they are not called Jews. And it's funny because you would think, how in the world should the real Jews not be called Jews? All right. Jeremiah 17 says, Jeremiah 17:3 says, O mountain in the field, I will give thy substance and all thy treasures to the spoil. So that means that the mountain in the field that he's talking about is Zion, the mountain of Jerusalem. He's going to give it to the spoil. And thy high places were seen throughout all thy borders. Watch this, it's in Jeremiah 17:4. And thou, even thyself, shall discontinue from thine heritage that I gave thee. And I will cause thee to serve thine enemies in a land which thou knowest not. But ye have kindled a fire in mine anger, which shall burn forever. So right here is telling us that the mountain in the field, which is symbolic of the kingdom of Israel, the people and the kingdom, their dominion, would cease from their heritage. It would discontinue. It says, thou thyself shalt discontinue from thy heritage. Now let's look at this word heritage. All right, we're going to figure out whether the people that's really the true Israelites are running around being called Israelites. All right? That right here, and it'll give you a quick answer. They can't be called Israelites. Now let's look at this word, 5150 here for heritage. Nakala. 5159, Nakala. It is in its usual sense, probably something inherited. All right. That is abstractly occupancy, or concretely an heirloom, generally an estate, patrimony, or portion, heritage to inherit. So basically, what these people inherited from God, they are not being called that any longer. All right? And thyself shall discontinue from thy heritage. Let's look at this word discontinue, 8058. So the true Israelites would discontinue from their heritage that he gave us. Who gave us? Yahweh Elohim. So Yahweh gave every nation a land and a spot and a place. But he gave Israel a certain place under him as being his chosen people. 8058, Shamat, all right, to fling down, incipiently, to jostle, figuratively, to let alone, desist, to remit, discontinue, to overthrow, to release, let rest, to shake, stumble, throw down. So they would, like the word says, they would discontinue from their heritage. So that means you have a people among the nations that are discontinued from their heritage. It's not hard to figure these people out. They have been slaves, all right? They call by bywords, every other thing but a child of God, okay? So I would say that the people that in the land is being called Jews, you have to check that. You gotta really wonder about that. Because he said they would discontinue from their heritage that I gave thee, and I will cause thee to serve thine enemies in the land, which thou knowest not. So these people would serve their enemies as slaves. That's what that means. Let's see, serve, 5647, abad, to work, but in any sense, by implication, to serve, till, enslaved. There it is, right there. Enslaved. All right. They would be enslaved. The B, keep in bondage. I like that, to keep in bondage. All right. See how, see why this thing, this study about Yahweh Elohim is important, to know who he is. It's easier to find us through studying him, because we are the people of Yahweh Elohim. Hold on just a moment. Make sure I get this highlighted correctly. We are the people of Yahweh Elohim. We are the only people on the face of the earth whose God is Yahweh Elohim. And what I mean people, I mean only nation. And there's people from other nations that are like a remnant that worship Yahweh Elohim. All right. And even what is it called? What's her name? Rahab the harlot. When Israel was going into the promised land to take it over, Rahab the harlot knew about Yahweh Elohim and said that they were afraid in that land of Jericho, they were afraid of it. Because she even said that, she said, Yahweh Elohim is the God in heaven and in earth, and our people are afraid. All right. So we're the only people, and we're going to go into that. I'm going to show you that in a little bit. In Joshua, the book of Joshua, chapter 2. But she's basically telling us right there from ancient times that we're the only people that Yahweh Elohim really protects and watches over. All right. So B, keep in bondage. This word for serve, we would serve our enemies in the land that we knew not, right? So keep in bondage, they would keep us in bondage. See that? About be bonded. See that? And that's Deuteronomy 28. Deuteronomy 28, 68. The Lord shall take you back to Egypt again in ships. The way in which I told you, you'd never see it again. And there should you serve your enemies for bond men and bond women, and no man shall buy you. That word buy kind of has the connotation of redeem. And you notice it said no man would buy you. But what about a God would buy you out of you? Because that God that would buy Israel in the latter days is called a Goal. He's a redeemer. All right? Bond service. Are we finished with our bond service among the nations? Because it is a service that we're doing until the time is over. Compel, do, dress, ear, execute. Well, we got enough proof of this word meaning enslave. Okay. And I'm only looking at it from the eastward and not from a exhaustive Strong's dictionary. So I would call thee to serve or be enslaved by thine enemies. But whoever would enslave these people among the nations, all right, would be their enemies. They would not be their friends. All right. I will call thee to serve thine enemies in the land that thou knowest not. Now, basically, Jeremiah, and this time of Jeremiah, I don't think Israel knew about this land over here. Judah was still in the land. This is the time during the time of Babylon, the Babylonian captivity, and the 10 northern tribes of Israel. Hold on just a moment. The 10 northern tribes of Israel have been carried into captivity by the Assyrians. So Jeremiah is a prophet to King of Judah, who is basically now in danger of going into captivity to Babylon. All right. And I don't think they really was aware of this land over here. All right. And thou shalt serve thine enemies in the land which thou knowest not, to give kindle the fire, and mine anger which shall burn forever. So what happened? They made Yahweh Elohim, Yahweh of the Lord God, angry. His fire and his anger would burn forever. Okay? So you see why it's good to study about Yahweh Elohim. All right? Because he is the God of Israel. Okay? Is Yahweh Shai the God of Israel? Yahweh Shai is the Lamb. The God of Israel sits on the throne, and the Lamb of God has washed us from our sins in his own blood. All right, is that important? Oh, yes, it is. But he isn't Yahweh Elohim. All right? Now, one thing about the other nations, I don't know if they've done this on purpose or they're doing it because it's just a lack of knowledge about it. But they're calling Jesus Christ, or Yahweh Elohim, Yahweh Shai, Yahweh Shai Mashiach, they're calling him God. And some people say that God is three persons, all right? That he's Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, God in three persons, all right? But the Bible doesn't call Yahweh Shai, God, outside of Yahweh, basically inhabiting him. All right, I'm trying to make sure I make this clear. Outside of Yahweh inhabiting Yahweh Shai Mashiach, the Bible doesn't call him God. All right? The Bible doesn't call him God. But the other nations, most of them, have one or a few different beliefs. Some say he's God. He's like oneness. Pentecostalism says that Jesus is really the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. All right? And the Catholics say that he's the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. All right? And some say he's just the Son of God. He's not God, which is really more correct than we give it an opportunity in our studies and our argument, that is more correct. But the problem with that is that there is a time when the Lamb is God. It's when the Father occupies the Son. And we studied this in the past, and I'm going back over some stuff that we've already studied, and I don't mind it, that when Yah first created the heavens and the earth, he did create Elohim. All right? So it's Bereshit, which is in the beginning, in Hebrew, Bereshit. And in the English, it says Elohim created, God created. But when you look in the Hebrew, what Moses wrote, the original writings, it says Bereshit in the beginning. He created, which is Bara. He created. Bara means he created. It doesn't say Elohim created. It says he created, and then it says Elohim, God. So if you look at it from the original, what Moses wrote, which you should go with the original, it goes Bereshit in the beginning. He created, which is Bara in Hebrew, Elohim. He created Elohim. The heaven and earth. So what happened was, and when you look at that, is that he created Elohim and the heaven and earth. He created somebody. He created somebody that he used to create the heavens and the earth. That's what Yahweh Shai was telling us, is that he was the one that Yah created to make the heavens and the earth. So he was like a garment. All right. A Sukkot, a tabernacle that Yah used to create the heavens and the earth. All right? Yah used him to create the heavens and the earth. All right? So he is special. And when he rose from the dead, his disciples and all of them bowed down to him and paid him homage, but they didn't worship him exactly. And when it does say worship him, who were they worshiping? Were they worshiping Yahweh that was in him, that was wearing him like when he wore him for creation? All right? But the Lamb doesn't sit on the throne. Let's go back there again. The Lamb doesn't sit on the throne. And we can go back to, let's see. We just looked at the scripture that says they would discontinue from their heritage. All right? And let's go to Revelation. What we were just talking about, Revelation 7. verses 7. Revelation 7, verse 10, and these people that was in the white robes, all right, basically cried with a loud voice, saying, salvation to our God that sitteth on the throne and unto the Lamb. So it's not the Lamb sitting on the throne. Salvation to our God that sitteth on the throne and is the Lamb right here. He's not sitting on the throne. All right. The Lamb doesn't sit on the throne. So basically it's saying the Lamb is not God. That Lamb is Yahweh Shai Mashiach. All right. The Lamb was sent ahead of Yahweh Elohim. Sent ahead of him. You know, he's basically his death is like the Lamb of the Passover. All right. It redeems, it washes from our sin. All right. He had to be a righteous person. All right. This Lamb had to be a righteous person. Otherwise, his blood would not have been able to wash us from our sin. Okay. So, verse 10 again says, and cry with a loud voice, saying, salvation to our God, which sitteth upon the throne. And what's amazing about this God that sits upon the throne is this down here. All right. Verse 15, therefore are they before the throne of God, and serve him day and night in his temple, and he that sitteth on the throne shall dwell among them. What? Now that, remember, is not Jesus. All right. The one that sits on the throne is not exactly Jesus. The one that sits on the throne even has seemingly a different skin complexion. He's a jasper and a sardine stone color. All right. Whereby it says Jesus looked like he had a skin complexion like it burned in the furnace. I don't know what all of that's to be taken seriously, but he had a skin complexion that looked like it was brass that had burned in the furnace. But right here it says, and he that sitteth on the throne shall dwell among the people. All right. Let's read that again. Therefore are they before the throne of God, and serve him day and night in his temple, and he that sitteth on the throne shall dwell among them. All right? That's what's amazing. This is what we don't hear much about this God that's going to dwell among us. The reason why is because of people's their lack of understanding about Yahweh. Some saying that he is Jesus, some saying that he's the Trinity. So they don't talk much about this, but I say, and I go along with the scripture that Yahweh Elohim and the Lamb are two different entities. The Lamb is not Yahweh Elohim. He's not the God of Israel. All right? The Lamb is not. Okay? But that makes Yahweh Elohim a different person, a different entity. Okay? That's what makes it so interesting. All right. Does Christianity, which is mostly Gentile and heathen, do they really know Yahweh Elohim? Do they have an idea who he really is? I really don't think they do. Because Yahweh Elohim is really meant for Israel to know. It's like he didn't allow that the nations, the Gentile nations, to really know him. You know, the way that they think they know him. It's for Israel. All right. So this is very interesting. It's a very interesting study because he's coming, he's coming down with his people. Yahweh Elohim is going to come down to dwell among his people like he's never done before. All right. He's coming down. All right. And if you believe that Jesus is him, that's no biggie. Jesus is coming back. No, Jesus is coming back. All right. But look at the way he's coming. Remember, Yahweh, Bereshit in Genesis 1, Bereshit, Bara, Alahayim, you know, Shamayim, and Eretz. In the beginning, God, in the beginning, he created Alahayim, the heavens and the earth. All right? Remember that. All right? So he created this person, which now we know is Jesus Christ. But Jesus didn't always exist. He was created. All right? He was created. John 1, let's go there real quick. John 1, 1. It's almost like Genesis 1, 1 all over again, but it's focusing on this person that's the Lamb. It's also called the Word right here in this case. All right? In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So what is that right there? The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him. Made by who? The Word. So right here, when we read Genesis 1:1, we see what happened. In the beginning, Bara, he created. In the beginning, he created Alahayim. This Alahayim was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was with him, the creator, the one that created. And the Word was God. So what happened? This God, all right, this God that created everything, and it doesn't say the Lamb created everything. This God, let me highlight it real quick. I like highlighting stuff. This God that created everything put on the Word, put him on like a garment, and created everything. All right, how do you know? All things were made by him, and without him was not anything. See that? All things were made by him and without him. That without right there is key. Without this Word that was created, was not anything made that was made. So without him, after he was created, when he created everything with Yahweh wearing him, without him was not anything made that was made. So Yahweh Shai, that lived 2,000 years ago and died on the cross, without him was not anything made that was made. But he's not called the creator. He was the one that was used to create everything, that Yah used to create everything, that Yah put him on like a garment. All right, how do you know? Well, this is called the high priestly prayer, John 17. These words spake Jesus and lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come, glorify thy Son, that thy Son may also glorify thee. All right. As thou hast given him power of all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as thou hast given him. And this is life eternal, that they may know thee. Right here, the only true God. So the one he's praying to is the only true God. Let me highlight this real quick. One Jesus is praying to is the only true God, that they may know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom thou hast sent. So the only true God sent Jesus Christ. Okay. Let's see, verse 4, and I have glorified thee on earth and finished the work which thou givest me to do. So God gave you this man that he called his son, Jesus Christ, a work to do. All right, just like in creation. All right. Verse 5, and now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self. See that? So what happened? In the beginning, he created Alahayim. All right, so what did he do? He created a person to put on to create. So Yahweh Shai said, glorify thou me with thine own self. So how does the Father glorify the Lamb with his own self? He put him on. So the Son was created for the purpose of being put on by the Father. When he's put on, and when the Father puts him on, now he is God. All right? He's God. The Father puts him on with his own self. He said, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory I had with thee before the world was. What did he do? He put this Son, he put this person he created on. Okay? Put him on. That's what he's talking about right here. Like, you know, you read that, you say, glorify that man with thine own self, with the glory. You know, it's a head scratcher, with thine own self. How do you glorify somebody with your own self? All right? Well, right there, it tells you, put him on, like a garment. All right? Like a tabernacle. He abided in him and used him to create. All right? I have manifested thy name unto the men which thou givest me out of the world, thine they were, and thou givest them me, and they have kept thy word. Okay? So right here, this is what's interesting. This is what's interesting. Is this Yahweh Elohim? Is he more interesting than Jesus Christ? You know, the Gentiles seem to worship Jesus Christ. They do. They do. And they're not too far off of it. You know, because when Yah puts him on, he is God. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. See? So they seem to worship him. But what's going on is that they don't understand this thing correctly. All right? And this Father, which is Yahweh Elohim, Yahweh Shai's Father, which is Yahweh Elohim, all right, he is the God of Israel. All right? So the heathen nations don't understand this to the fullest degree. All right? They don't understand this. They read the scriptures and they got their own ideas about it. And they worship Jesus. Part way, as we just read in John chapter 1, verse 1, part of the way they're right, part of the way they're wrong. Half off, half wrong, half right. Like I used to be. I used to put it together that Yahweh Shai was the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. You know. But I wouldn't go on with the Trinity doctrine. But it's saying the same thing, sort of. But the nations don't know this Yahweh Elohim. All right? They know of him. But he is not exactly Jesus Christ. He's the creator. Okay? And it's very interesting because this is what Israel got to know at their deliverance. See, Israel's among the nations and scattered sheep among the nations. Let me show you something. Let's see, Jeremiah. The word that Jeremiah 50 verse 1, the word that Yahweh spake against Babylon, against the land of the Chaldeans by Jeremiah the prophet. Now we're reading this, and the prophecy is against Babylon. Babylon that seemingly took Judah, the kingdom of Judah, into captivity. But the things that happened to Babylon in this prophecy is not what happened to them thousands of years ago. So this Babylon would be in existence some type of way spiritually in the latter day, and it would suffer those judgments that we're going to read. Declare ye among the nations and publish and set up a standard, publish and conceal not. Say, Babylon is taken, Baal. So Baal is Babylon's Baal. All right. You open up any Bible that you get into and you read, even this eastward calls Yahweh Baal. All right, calls him Baal because the word Lord is really Baal. When we just go ahead and just say, when we see the Lord and all of that, we just go ahead and say Yahweh. And when you press on the word for the Lord, it says Yahweh. All right, Baal is confounded, Merodach is broken in pieces, her idols are confounded, her images are broken in pieces. But this is talking about the latter days, y'all. All right, well, out of the north, there cometh a nation against her which shall make her land desolate. And none shall dwell therein. They shall remove, they shall depart, both man and beast. So Israel would be in a Babylon in captivity all the way into the latter day. All right? Israel would be in a Babylon in captivity all the way into the latter day. Until what time? Until Yahweh Elohim comes on the scene. So right here is telling us that Yahweh Elohim is coming. And this time when he comes, he's not coming in an invisible format. he's coming where you can visibly see him. All right? Yahweh Elohim is coming where you can see him. Well, let's read that again. For out of the north there cometh a nation against her, which shall make her land desolate, and none shall dwell therein. But they shall remove, they shall part both men and beasts. So this Babylon is where Israel is at, all the way up to the end, until Yahweh Elohim comes and gets her out of there. Kind of like he came with Moses and got Israel out of Egypt. But this time it won't be a Moses. It's going to be really Yahweh Elohim. All right. For in those days and at that time, saith Yahweh, verse 4, the children of Israel shall come, they and the children of Judah together, going and weeping, and they shall go and seek. Guess who? So Israel's going to catch on to this, what we're talking about right here. All right? Israel's going to catch on to this truth. They already know that they forsake the law, but what's the major law? Here, Israel, Yahweh Elohim, it's one Yahweh. Thou shalt love Yahweh the Elohim with all thy heart, mind, soul, body, and strength. That's the major law. All right? But they're going to go and they're going to find this and keep this law right here, loving Yahweh Elohim more than anything. But right now, I'm going to be honest with you, just to think about it. I see a lot of Hebrew Israelites on the street corners, a lot of Jews talking about keeping the laws and all of that. But one thing I don't hear them talking about is loving Yahweh Elohim. This thing that we're talking about right here about Yahweh Elohim. How is he coming? How and what is he? All right? They shall go and seek Yahweh the Elohim. Seek. They're going to go and seek. All right? They shall ask the way. Going to seek Yahweh the Elohim is asking the way to Zion with their faces vividly, saying, come and let us join ourselves to Yahweh in a perpetual covenant that shall not be forgotten. All right, now watch this. Verse 6, Jeremiah 50, verse 6. My people have been lost sheep. Their shepherds have caused them to go astray. Let me read that again. My people have been lost sheep. Who's speaking here? Yahweh Elohim. My people have been lost sheep. Their shepherds have caused them to go astray. All the way up until the end, even with Christianity. So what's wrong with Christianity that's causing his sheep to be lost? Because when I look around, I look at a lot of these people that obviously don't have an identity, that have been enslaved, that have lost their heritage, don't know who they are. When I look at these people that are lost, all right, they seem to be Christian. Most of them seem to be Christian and believe in Jesus, and they keep Christmas, Easter, New Year's, most of the pagan days, what we would call pagan holidays, that seem to have a little traditional worship of Jesus. All right? But right here, you can tell that among the nations, these people have shepherds. See, their shepherds have caused them to go astray. So I would say that the shepherds that caused them to go astray are Christian. All right? Let me highlight this. Their shepherds have caused them to go astray. Have caused them to go astray. That word is have caused them to go astray is 85:82. Let's look at that. Tall, 85:82. Vacillate, that is the real, to stray, to go astray, to deceive. Remember, how what should be the sign of your coming and all of this, the end time? He said, take heed that no man deceive you, but many shall come in my name, saying that I am Christ, and shall deceive many. All right? To go astray, to deceive, to dissemble, cause to make, to err, pant, seduce, stagger, cause to wander out of the way. That's what that means, to wander out of the way. So how have the shepherds, which are most likely Christian pastors, how have these shepherds caused God's people to go astray? That believe in the same Jesus. All right, is it like what we've been talking about here? That they have gone astray from worshiping Yahweh Elohim. They're worshiping the Lamb, they believe in Jesus, but they are not worshiping Yahweh Elohim. All right. It's not that these people would go to hell that have been deceived, led astray. Because remember, the rich young ruler came and asked Jesus, what good thing? Call him good master. Yahweh Shai corrected him for that. Why callest thou me good? There's none good but God. All right. But he said, good master, what good thing must I do to inherit eternal life? And he said, what does the commandment say? He named all six of the last six of the Ten Commandments, which is loving your neighbor as yourself. Yahweh Shai said, do this and you will live. And he didn't even mention the first four. All right. So you can have eternal life with the last six and not even be worshiping Yahweh God. But the problem is that when you worship the first four, now you put yourself in league with Yahweh Allah, the God of Israel. And that's the kingdom. The kingdom is worshiping Yahweh Allah. Right? Now, check this out. You want the kingdom. All right? You want the kingdom, not just to have eternal life. You can have eternal life without getting the kingdom. A kingdom is eternal rulership and dominion. All right? Which Israel is going to get in the end. Why? Because they go and weep and they seek Yahweh, their Allah. So they get the kingdom and the dominion. Because they find Yahweh, their Allah. See how this thing works? Now, remember, the rich young ruler asked Yahweh Shai, what good thing must I do to have eternal life? He mentioned the last six, which has nothing to do with worshiping Yahweh Allah. It means loving your neighbors yourself. All right. He said, do this and you will live. Then he said, let me see. I'll go there later. But most of you that know these scriptures, read that scripture before, know that this is true. That you don't have to worship Yahweh Allah to have eternal life. Really don't. According to what Yahweh Shai said in that scripture. Okay? Love your neighbors yourself and get eternal life. The problem is that the kingdom is all of glory. Okay? The kingdom is the glory. It's the dominion, the glory, and all of that. All right? You just want to get in, you know, like the song said, I'm doing my best to make it in, you know? You just want to just make it in? No. You don't want to just make it in. All right? You want the kingdom. Because, you know, a lot of people are going to have eternal life. All right. Some loving their neighbors themselves. But that they love Yahweh their Alahayim. But they love Yahweh Alahayim. All right. That's the kingdom. All right. My people have been lost sheep. Their shepherds have caused them to go astray. What did the shepherds cause Israel to go astray from? From worshiping Yahweh their Alahayim. So there's going to be a lot of them that are going to have eternal life, but they're not going to get the kingdom. They're not going to be with the true Israelites in the kingdom. And Yahweh Shai mentioned, they said, many are going to come from the north, east, west, south, sit down with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom. But the children of the kingdom should be cast in outer darkness. It's not that they went to hell, it's just that they didn't get the reward of the kingdom. All right? They didn't get the reward of the kingdom. The children of the kingdom, which would be the children of Israel. All right. Many of them were deceived. As shepherds, they believed in these shepherds and had them worshiping Jesus and doing the last six commandments, basically saying that the law was done away with. So if the law is done away with, then basically the law about worshiping Yahweh Allah, the first four commandments, is done away with, all right? You can't help but believe that, you know, that if the law is done away with, and to observe the law, you're sinning, you're doing wrong, and worshiping Yahweh Allah and seeking him is wrong. All right? But my people have been lost sheep. Their shepherds have caused them to go astray. They have turned them away on the mountains. They have gone from mountains to hills. So who is this people talking about? It's talking about Israel. Not talking about the Christians. It's talking about the Israelites. They have turned them away on the mountains. They have gone from mountain to hill. They have forgotten. Remember what we just read in Jeremiah, where they were going to cease from their heritage, Jeremiah 17? All right. And they was going to be, they were going to serve the enemies of the land that they knew not. Right here it says they have forgotten their resting place. So part of serving your enemies in the land that you know not is to not worship Yahweh Elohim for Israel. So what did these people do? All right, let's go on down here a little further. What was their real fault? Their shepherds have caused them to go astray. They have turned them away on the mountain. They have gone from mountain to hill. They have forgotten their resting place. All that found them, watch this, all that found them have devoured them. All that found these people devoured. Okay? See how important this is for the children of Israel? All that found them have devoured them. Even with Christianity, they basically going to heaven, but they're going to heaven in a bad way. They didn't get the kingdom, okay? These people were cheated out of the kingdom. All that found them have devoured them. All right, that means that here on earth, they got the curses. They're going to heaven, but they suffering the curses on earth. All that found them have devoured them. And part of devouring them is just look at the curses in Deuteronomy 28. You know, the people that bought a certain group of people over here made them slaves, okay? They were Christians. Bought them over here and made them slaves. And they did all types of atrocities to them, you know? A man would marry a slave woman, a bond man would marry a bond woman, and the slave master, who was a Christian, was going to sleep with the man's wife. Okay, all that found them have devoured them. Hold on just a moment. Just a moment. All right. All that found them have devoured them. This is what Christianity was evil in. How was Christianity evil? It taught Israel in their belief that was really partly true. All right. It taught Israel to worship the Lamb and not Yahweh Elohim. All right. It taught Israel to not worship Yahweh Elohim. That Yahweh Elohim was not that important. It taught Israel that Yahweh Elohim was the lamb that died 2,000 years ago. Remember what we just saw, that the lamb, that the Yahweh Elohim sits on the throne, and the lamb is sitting beside the throne, and standing beside the throne. Okay? The disciples in Acts chapter 1 asked Jehoshaphat when he rose from the dead, will you at this time restore the kingdom again to Israel? Even they was kind of like clueless. And he said, it's not for you to know the times or the season the Father has placed in his own hand. The Father has placed that in his hand when the kingdom is going to be restored to Israel. Even the disciples were kind of clueless a little bit right there. The Father is the one that restores the kingdom to Israel. And as a matter of fact, the heathen nations that believe in Jesus, that they really love Jesus, they really love eternal life, they want to live forever, they should really root these people on in finding Yahweh Elohim. Because it's only through them that death is swallowed up in victory. When Yahweh Elohim restores the kingdom to Israel. Right? All that found them have devoured them. All right. And their adversary said, these people that found them, who we call Christians, their adversary said, we offend not. All right, see that? Their adversaries said, we offend not, because they have sinned against Yahweh. Look at this. This is where he gets upset and angry. We offend not because they have sinned against Yahweh. And they didn't lie on that. Oh, y'all knew about this, huh? You Christians, huh? You knew that my people sinned against me, the habitation of justice, even Yahweh, the hope of their fathers. So they knew this. Watch this. This is what Yahweh says after that. Remove out of the midst of Babylon and go forth out of the land of the Chaldeans. Be as the he goes before the flock. He's saying, get out of there because I'm going to destroy it. It's like he destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. That's what's going on here. These people knew that. They knew that these people had sinned against Yahweh, and that they were using them because of their sins with the hope of Christianity, knowing that they got the kingdom when they go all the way back. And to keep them from the kingdom and cause them to serve like them in Christianity, chase them out of the kingdom. So they knew that. So he tells them to remove out of the midst of Babylon, go forth out of the land of the Chaldean and be as the eagles before the flocks. For I will raise and cause to come up against Babylon an assembly of great nations from the north country. And they shall set themselves in array against her, and then she shall be taken. Their arrows shall be as a mighty expert man, none shall return in vain. And these arrows, it's not really like literally arrows. These are symbolic of these missiles, nuclear missiles. But remember, she's going to be burned with fire. And Chaldea should be a spoil. All that spoiled her should be satisfied. All right? Because you were glad, because you rejoiced over your destroyers of my inheritance. Remember, he said you're going to cease from your heritage, that these people were destroying Yahweh Elohim's heritage. They knew what they were doing. See that? Because you were glad. You were glad about this. Glad 8055. Let's check out that word glad. And it's glad about it. Shamak. To brighten up, that is. To bleed or be blithe or gleesome. Cheer up. To be glad. Be or make glad. Make merry, to rejoice. They rejoiced at that. They were happy. Man. Oh, my goodness. Oh, you mean all we got to do is make these people and lead them to be Christians like us and cheat them out of the kingdom and we get all their stuff? They get cursed? Okay, let's do it. Because you were glad, because you rejoiced, oh, you destroyers of mine heritage. They destroyed Yahweh Elohim's heritage. All right? Which were these people? That goes to show you that Yahweh Elohim would come down in the end. And this would be his heritage. These people, this nation. All right? Because you are grown fat as a heifer of grass and bellow as bulls. Your mother shall be sore confounded. She that bare you shall be, you shall be ashamed. Behold, the hindermost of the nation shall be a wilderness, a dry land in the desert. Because of the wrath of Yahweh shall not be inhabited, but it shall be wholly desolate. Everyone that went by Babylon shall be astonished. He hissed at all their plagues. That Babylon of ancient times didn't happen to it. But this is talking about in the latter days. All right. So this Israel in the latter days is in serious captivity, where they've been deceived and led astray by the religion of their enemies, by their religion of their captives, okay? All right? Put yourselves in array against Babylon, round about all ye that bend the bow. Shoot at her, spare no arrows, for she hath sinned against Yahweh. See that? How does she sin against Yahweh? By leading his people astray, teaching them not to worship Yahweh Elohim. In a religion that's really kind of true. They were deceived. Shout against her round about. She have given her hand, her foundations have fallen, her walls are thrown down. For it is the vengeance of Yahweh. Take vengeance upon her as she has done, do unto her. You see this in Revelation chapter 18, in Mystery Babylon, the Great Mother of Harlots. It says to do the same thing. You know, give her the cup she has filled, give her double. Cut off the sword from Babylon and him that handled the sickle. In a time of harvest, for fear of their presence ward, they shall turn everyone to his people. They shall flee everyone to his own land. Verse 17, Israel is a scattered sheep. The lions have driven him away first. The king of Assyria have devoured him. Remember the 10 northern tribes are led out of the land and taken into captivity by the king of Assyria in 722 BC. And last is Nebuchadnezzar, which happened somewhere around 605 BC. Took the kingdom of Judah in the captivity. The king of Babylon had broken his bones. Therefore, thus saith Yahweh of hosts, the God of Israel, Behold, I will punish the king of Babylon in his land as I punished the king of Assyria. I will bring Israel again to his habitation and shall feed, and he shall feed on Carmel and Bashan, and his soul shall be satisfied upon Ephraim and Gilead. In those days and at that time, saith Yahweh, the iniquity of Israel shall be sought for, and there shall be none, and the sins of Judah, they shall not be found, for I will pardon them whom I reserve. All right. Go up against the land of Meribah, against it and against the inhabitants of Pekah, waste, and utterly destroy after them, saith Yahweh, and do according to all that I have commanded thee. A sound of battles in the land of great destruction. How is the hammer of the whole earth cut in sunder and broken? How has Babylon become a desolation among the nations? I've laid a snare for thee, thou art also taken, O Babylon, thou was not aware. Thou art found and also called, because thou hast striven against Yahweh. So when they was really misleading and deceiving the children of Israel like sheep, they were striving against Yahweh. Yahweh has opened his armory and has brought forth the weapons of his indignation, for this is the work of Adonai, Yahweh of hosts in the land of the Chaldeans. Come against her from the utmost border, open the storehouses, cast her up as the heaps, destroy her utterly, let nothing of her be left. Slay all her bullocks. Talking about the mighty warriors and police and mighty men. Let them go down to the slaughter, woe unto them, for their day has come, the time of their visitation. Force it in the flee and escape out of the land of Babylon, and declare in Zion the vengeance of Yahweh Elohim, vengeance of his temple. So some type of way, this is the same people that's controlling Babylon in the latter day that destroyed his temple. And it's the vengeance of Yahweh Elohim. Now check this out. I'm going to give you a little hint here. If Yahweh comes down here, right, secretly, he's a regular man, this is the vengeance of his temple, that temple right there, which is the Hebrew for 1964, all right? The vengeance of his temple, is that temple really his body? Or is it the physical temple that was torn down in 70 AD, or both? Did this have something to do with what they did to him physically? So that means when he comes upon the earth, will they do what it will, he suffer physically because of these people. Let me read that again. The voice of them that flee, escape out of the land of Babylon, to declare in Zion the vengeance of Yahweh Elohim, the vengeance of his temple. All right. I'm looking at that number, it's 1964, Hebrew 1964. Was he born in 1964? But anyway, call together the archers against Babylon, all you that bend the bow, camp against it round about, that none dare escape. Recompense her according to her word, according to all she has done, do unto her, for she had been proud against Yahweh, against the Holy One of Israel. So really, he was down here and she was proud against him. He was walking around just like a regular Hebrew Israelite, and they were proud. Therefore shall her young men fall in the streets, and all her men of war shall be cut off in the day, in that day, saith Yahweh. Behold, I'm against thee, O thou most proud, saith Adonai Yahweh of hosts, but thy day has come, the time that I will visit thee. Now, check this out now. Israel's gonna catch on. Now, we saw earlier in the earlier verses of this chapter, Israel's gonna go and weeping and crying, Israel and Judah, and they're gonna seek Yahweh the Elohim. Where they find him? And if they find him, they're gonna find every literal person. A person. And I'm gonna prove this to you in a second or two. All right. Oh, thou most proud, and the most proud shall stumble and fall, and none shall rise him up. And I will kindle a fire in his cities, and he shall devour all round about. So these missiles are going to cause fire. All right. Now you can see that it's at the time when Babylon is going to get destroyed. Now it's up to you to figure out what is Babylon, which city is Babylon. But I can tell you what city is Babylon. All right. And you should be able to figure it out for yourself. Which one is Babylon? But at the time of the destruction of this place, it's when these things will happen. And Yahweh Elohim will be revealed. All right? Thus saith Yahweh of hosts, children of Israel and the children of Judah were oppressed together. All that took them captives held them fast. They refused to let them go. Check this out. Their Redeemer is strong. Now, if you look at this, their Redeemer is not Yahusha. Who is the Redeemer of Israel? The Redeemer of Israel is Yahweh Elohim. Job says something I mention it all the time. He says, I know that my Redeemer lives. And in the latter day, he will stand on here. All right, the Redeemer. And when we see Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 68, it says, no man shall buy you at the end of that verse. Why? Because that Redeemer is Yahweh of hosts, it's Yahweh Elohim. He's not really just only a man. He is Yahweh. The Redeemer is strong. Yahweh opposes his name. He shall thoroughly plead their cause that he may give rest to the land and disquiet the inhabitants of Babylon. A sword is a bone, their child in, saith Yahweh, and upon the inhabitants of Babylon, and upon her princes, and upon her wise men. I can probably let this go right here. Go on to the next thing. But right here, it says that when we look at Revelation, it says, one that sits on the throne shall dwell among the people. Now, look at this. Let's check something out here in the book of Daniel. Now, if you Bible scholars out there, and I'm literally preaching to a lot of people that are Bible scholars, mostly. But the way I do it is it's not hard for even the beginner to figure it out. That Daniel has this dream of the four kings that will rise up after Babylon, during the time of Babylon and after Babylon, that would rule over the nations until the coming of the kingdom of God upon the earth. You have the lion, which is Babylon. You have the bear, Media Persia. All right, you have the leopard with wings on his back and four heads, Greece, Alexander the Great. Greek kingdom. And then you have this, look like, what is it, a dragon? Seven heads and 10 horns. It's basically the Roman Empire that ruled 2,000 years ago. And it's an extension of Rome, which has something to do with a religious dominion with a little horn. All right. Check this out. At the end of these, at the end of this rulership, which has something to do with the little horn, this religious rulership over the world, and the little horn has something to do with taking Israel into captivity in the latter days, had them religiously bound. What did we just read? The shepherds caused them to go astray, right? What shepherds? They're religious shepherds. They were sheep and the religious shepherds. Causing the voice straight. And then figured it out later on that they understood what they were doing. That they understood that they were leading these people astray. I beheld, see, Daniel chapter 7, verse 9. So after all of this, the religious dominion that had Israel in captivity where the shepherds were causing the people to go astray. I beheld till the thrones were cast down. That means whoever was ruling, all of them were cast down. And guess who? The Ancient of Days did sit. So what happened? Some type of way, something happened. All right? And I think I'm going to try that. I'm going to try to show you how this thing works. The Ancient of Days did sit. Who was Ancient of Days? The Ancient of Days is Yahweh Elohim. All right? The Ancient of Days did sit. The thrones were cast down, the Ancient of Days did sit. So when he came and sat, throne will cast down his garment. Now check this out. The Ancient of Days garment was white as snow. Now, where did we see something like that before, where the garment was white as snow? We saw that in Revelation chapter 7, right? Where we saw a group of people from all nations and tongues and people that had white garments on, and their garments had been washed in the blood of the Lamb. They had come through great tribulation. They had, they had some type of palm branches in their hand, right? With symbolic of the day of the Feast of Trumpets, the Feast of Sukkot, with the palm branches in their hand. But look at this, they had white garments on, right? Which means that their garments had been washed in the blood of the Lamb. Well, check this out, this Ancient of Days, whose garment was, guess what? White as snow. Let me see here. This right here should be the end of the matter. That the Ancient of Days had come down from the throne up in heaven, and lived as a human being upon the earth, and washed his garment in the blood of the Lamb. That's why he dwells among the people, right? In Revelation chapter 7, he would dwell among the people. He has a white garment on, just like the other folks that had the palm branches in their hand that was saying salvation to our God and also to the Lamb. Salvation to the one that sits on the throne and also to the Lamb. That's what they said in Revelation chapter 7. All right, but he has a white garment on, white as snow. See that? What does that tell you? That means that he was down here. He took advantage of the washing of the blood of the Lamb. And he had that going through tribulation. We just read in Jeremiah, it says, this is the vengeance of Yahweh Elohim and the vengeance of his temple. So when you look at that, you say, was that just only the temple that was torn down in 70 AD? Or was that his temple that he's dwelling in on the earth when he comes down here? Unknowingly. All right. And we know Yahawashi got crucified. Right? But it says Yahweh Elohim and the vengeance of his temple. See? Now, when you read the book of Jeremiah, what is it? Isaiah chapter 53. You read that chapter, many people attribute that wholeheartedly to Yahawashi. But there's some things in there that Yahawashi doesn't fulfill. It's more like this person right here fulfills most of it. This Yahweh Elohim, this Ancient of Days. All right? But it says that he was sick. This Ancient of Days was a man that suffered sickness. You look at the word and look at the Hebrew readings of that. Yahawashi didn't suffer sickness. All right? I don't see anywhere in the scriptures where he suffers sickness. Okay. Now you can say when he's on the cross, but this person that's in Isaiah 53 seems to have been a man that was going through some trouble. But the Ancient of Days has a garment white as snow. I mean, so it's not that he lived a totally righteous life like Yahawashi, but is washed in the blood of the Lamb. All right? And his hair of his head was pure wool. All right? His throne was like a fiery flame, and his wheels was burning fire. Fury stream issued and came forth from before him. 1,000 ministered unto him, and 10,000 times 10,000s stood before him. The judgment was set, and the books were open. So what happened to cause the Ancient of Days to sit? Because when the Ancient of Days sits, he sits on the earth. He's not sitting up in heaven. All right? Basically, this is the Ark of the Covenant. What's the Ark of the Covenant was? This is that very, very thing. The Ark of the Covenant, where you have Yahweh sitting between the cherubim. Okay? That's what's going on here. What causes this to happen? Okay? It says, a furious stream issued came forth before him. 1,000 ministered unto him. 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. Judgment was set. The books was open. All right. So what's going on? Now, you know, they don't say anything about the Lamb, right? That right there should tell you something. Don't say anything about the Lamb all of a sudden coming. It says the Ancient of Days came. All right. Hold on just a moment. I'm going to put you on pause so I can take a quick break. All right, back. It was just that you notice that this doesn't say, I beheld till the Lamb showed up on the scene. I beheld till the Lamb, the thrones were cast down and the Lamb showed up. But there's a result of the Lamb on this Ancient of Days. That's the garment that's white as snow. That he had also went through great tribulation with his people. See that? So his garment was white as snow, head like pure wool. His throne was as a fiery flame, and his wheels as burning fire. All right. A fiery stream issued and came forth from before him, and thousands and thousands ministered unto him. 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. His judgment was set, the books was open. So this is one of the ways that Yah is going to know what was going on, because he came down here his own self. All right. Now, I'm going to show you something. Then in the book of Genesis, chapter 10 or 11, when it speaks about when the people were in a place called Babel, which has something to do with Babylon. They were in a place called Babel. They wandered to a city, an area called Babel. And they started building a tower called Babel. A great tower to reach under heaven. What does it say Yahweh did? He came down to look at the city that they were building. That right there should tell you something. All right. He came down and then he said that people, nothing would be impossible for them if they allowed to go ahead and do what they're doing. So he divided their tongues and languages and spread them about on the earth. That was also Babel. All right. But the thing was, look at this. He came down from heaven, beheld the city. All right. We might look at that a little later on. Daniel 7:12, as concerning the rest of the beast, they had the dominion taken away, yet their life belonged for a season and a time. So what happens? Yahweh comes down and puts an end himself to the beastly system that's ruling and reigning and misleading his people. He comes down. What causes him? What causes it to happen? Okay. It's going to happen all of a sudden, too. All right. I saw in the night vision, watch this. Now, this is what right here should really have you thinking. I saw in the night vision, and behold, one like the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven. Now, here's Yahweh Shai. Here's Yahweh Shai. He's the body of the believers, right? You ever heard of the body of Christ, which is really talking about the people that believe in Jesus all together as one man, as body of Christ, right? Here's the Son of Man right here, Yahweh Shai. I saw in the night vision, and behold, one like the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven. Now, when I used to read this, when I'm thinking that Jesus was God, I thought of him going up. He was on the earth, and then he went up into heaven. But really, he's coming down. He's at the right hand of the God up in heaven. He comes down. He comes down with the clouds. Remember the two angels that stood before the disciples in Acts chapter 1? Said, "You men of Israel, why stand you looking and gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, which is taken from you, shall come in like manner." So we see this right here. He's coming down. The Son, the Ancient of Days is already down here. All right? We just saw that. The Ancient of Days is already here. It's already here. I saw in a night vision, behold, one like the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven. And came to the, guess who he came to? Came to the Ancient of Days. Let me highlight this. Came to the Ancient of Days. The Ancient of Days is on the earth. He's like the Ark of the Covenant. He got two powerful angelic cherubim right beside him, one on the right, one on the left. Came to the Ancient of Days and they brought him near before him. So this one that's the Lamb is being brought near before the Ancient of Days. Now just think of that. if you know that the lamb is powerful, but just think how powerful this person is, that they bought the lamb, Jesus, before him. All right? So what happens right here? Well, remember he said, glorify thy me with thine own self, which I had with thee before the world was. Here's that time right here. This is when that happens. Okay? We just read it in John chapter 17. Let me go back there again. I just want to make sure that y'all see that. So he prayed to the Father in John chapter 17, right? Here we go. It's John 17. John 17, verse 5. And now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory I had with thee before the world was. So here this is happening. This is what it takes place of. He prayed that prayer, and this is where the prayer, the answer to that prayer takes place of. He's coming down to the Ark of the Covenant, which is the Ancient of Days. It comes from heaven. All right, let me go back to what we just said. So on the night vision, behold, one like the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven and came to the Ancient of Days. Now, some people say, like I used to say, it's talking about the Son of Man is on the earth going up to heaven. Well, let's take another look at this what's going to happen here. Let's go to Mark. I think it's Mark. When he's standing before the chief priest, they ask him, are you the Son of the Highest? Are you the Son of God? Mark chapter 14, excuse me. Jesus before the council right here. Let's see what the chief priest is going to ask him. Chief priest, but he held his peace and answered nothing. Mark chapter 14, verse 61. Again, the high priest asked him and said unto him, art thou the Christ, the Son of the Blessed? Mark 14, 62. Jesus said, I am. And you shall see the Son of Man sitting on the right hand of power, that's somewhat up in heaven, and coming in the clouds of heaven. See that? So is he coming up from the earth? Or is he coming from heaven? He's coming from heaven. You're going to see him sitting on the right hand of God and coming in the clouds of heaven. He's coming from heaven. Okay? As you can see, I'm going to show that to you again. And Jesus said, I am. You shall see the Son of Man sitting on the right hand of power, which is God, and coming in the clouds of heaven. I always used to wonder why he said sitting on the right hand of power. I used to wonder about that. But I also wonder why it says, you know, in Revelation chapter 7, salvation unto him that sitteth upon the throne, like as if he's not there on the throne, and unto the Lamb. So where is this person that's supposed to be on the throne in the latter day? Is he down here on earth, living as a regular human being? All right? Sitting on the right hand of power and coming in the clouds of heaven. So he's coming from heaven to the Ancient of Days. So let's go back where we just said. He's coming from heaven to the Ancient of Days who was on the earth. Okay, so let me go back here. Daniel 7. And I saw in the night visions. Chat, let me see, hold on just a moment. I'll try to answer this chat real quick. Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now? end of that. So something happened. Ends up the meeting. Okay, maybe they come back. All right, sorry about that. So I saw in the night vision, behold, one like the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven. Remember, he just said, you're going to see me sitting on the right hand of power and coming in the clouds. So he came in the clouds to the Ancient of Days. All right, so this Ancient of Days is Yahweh Elohim, who's on earth. And they brought him there before him. All right, hold on just a moment. And they brought him there before him. All right, so I want y'all to really look at that really good. This is what's gonna change for you. This is what's gonna cause Israel to get the kingdom. So what is Israel searching for? The kingdom, okay? Israel's gonna have world dominion, worldwide dominion. They're gonna have the kingdom. And this person right here, the Ancient of Days, remember Yahweh said, it's not for you to know the times or seasons that the Father's put in his own power. So the Father himself comes down and puts it in his own power, okay? And the Father is whisked away, and we see this in Revelation. I think Drake had a good word on it. Revelation chapter 12. When you see Revelation 12, and it's talking about the man child, guess what it's talking about? It's talking about that man child, that the father. She brought forth a man child, Revelation 12, verse 5. She brought forth a man child who was to rule all nations. Of a rod of iron, and her child was called up unto God into his throne, in his throne. So who is this that's called up unto God into his throne? We, you know, you would normally think of it as Jesus. All right, now when Jesus talks, when the person that looked at as Jesus in Revelation 1 speaks about these things that's going to happen in the book of Revelation, he said these things are yet to come to pass. But these things come to pass after Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. All right? So who is it that's going to be called up to God, called up unto God in his throne? Who is it? Okay? It's not Jesus. Jesus is already ascended to the right hand of the Father, okay? But this would happen in the future, in the time to come. It was caught up unto God, and when we read this, we don't think of it, that whoever this is caught up to being God. Let me see, 43:14, what's that word, unto? Caught up unto God. Let's look at that real quick. Toward God. Let's see, pertaining to God. Near to God. All right. Now remember, Yahweh said he was going to be sitting on the right hand of the power. Okay. So the right hand of who? The right hand of God. Who is the power? But this right here says this child was called up unto God in his throne. Okay. This is in our day and time right here. So we see Yahweh Shai. Let's go back where we just said. Daniel chapter 7. It's coming with the clouds, comes down to the Ancient of Days. And we knew that the Ancient of Days, the Ark of the Covenant, was just a symbolic of. Right, the Ark of the Covenant has the cherubim sitting right beside both sides of him. All right, so he comes down and they bring Yahawashi, the Son of Man, before the Ancient of Days, and he's glorified in his person. So what happens there? The Ancient of Days, who's got the dominion already, all right, because even though we just saw that he had the dominion, the throne was cast down, and he got the dominion, then the Son of Man comes, and this Ancient of Days puts him on. Okay, this is what causes the dominion of the church, of whoever's going to get the kingdom dominion in the latter days. All right, the glory and all of that. This is the judgment seat of Christ. He's going to put the Ancient of Days is going to put the Son of Man on. What does it say? And it was given him dominion, glory, and the kingdom that all nations, people, nations, languages should serve him. His kingdom, his dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom that which shall not be destroyed. So he basically puts the Son of Man on. When he puts the Son of Man on, everybody that's in Christ, that has been ordained to be blessed and get the kingdom and all of that, it's going to get dominion and get the kingdom. But who gets the kingdom, what causes this to happen, is that the Ancient of Days takes over himself, which is the Father. He comes down and takes over himself. He takes it over. We saw that in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, that the Son at a certain time is going to give the dominion, the kingdom, and back unto God the Father. Let's go there real quick. So the Son has the dominion right now. He's sitting on the right hand. He's sitting on the right hand of the power, all right? Let's go down here a little further. 1 Corinthians 15, 24, then come up the end, all right? Then come up the end, when he shall have delivered up the kingdom to God, even the Father. He shall put down all rule and authority and power. For he must reign till he hath put all enemies under his feet. The last enemy that should be destroyed is death. So what happens? It looks like the Father destroys death. He comes down, destroys death. And you could say, now Jesus destroyed death in his own body. Yeah, he did. Or did the Father basically raise him up from the dead because it was not possible that death could hold him? I think the Father rose up Jesus from the dead. And waited until this time right here. Okay? Even when he rolls him up, he never seen it. But he must reign till he had put all enemies under his feet. The last enemy that shall be destroyed is death. Now, we know that Yahweh Elohim lives. That means it's impossible for Yahweh Elohim to die. So what happens? He has to come to a point where it's over with. He's just, you know, like a popcorn, pow, opens up and he becomes who he really is. Okay? We have put all things under his feet, but when he said all things are put under him, it's manifest that he has accepted that he has put all things under him. All right, so we won't go too far into that at this time, but but this is the reason why it's important to understand who Yahweh Elohim is. We don't, as Israelites, we don't want just Christianity. Really, we don't. Because in Christianity, we still have to suffer the curses. Some might not. All right? But most of us would suffer the curses. if your people are suffering curses and you're not, you might as well consider yourself suffering the curses too. You know? Because it's not going to be good for you that you can't help your people. All right? But this is what the problem is right here. That Yah's people have been led astray, like, you know, sheep led astray by the shepherds of the major religion in the world. And they knew what they were doing. We just read in Jeremiah 50, they said they sinned against Yahweh, their Elohim. Now, what did we just say? That basically he's keeping the last six commandments, loving your neighbor as you love yourself. You can have you can have eternal life. You won't get the kingdom. You can have eternal life. But loving Yahweh Elohim will get you the kingdom and eternal life. Right? But these people knew what they were doing. They kept the people from really serving Yahweh Elohim. They allowed them to get the eternal life and kept them from really getting the kingdom. All right? That kingdom is dominion over the world. So they kept these people from getting dominion over the whole world. Because they wanted the dominion. They wanted the rule. They did it through religion. It's really something else, all right? We just saw that in Jeremiah chapter 50. All right? That's the reason why Yahweh destroys Babylon. Because of they basically led his people astray. Because of the shepherds destroyed Babylon. All right. So people pray that Yah will, that our people will find Yahweh the Elohim. It's really something else. I'm surprised that nobody's talking about this. And I'm going to continue to talk about these things and to study this. All right. Now, this is the end of the seventh month. And we just went through the most holy days of the year. We just came past last week the Feast of Tabernacles, which is Sukkot, which has something to do with Yahweh Elohim, all right, reigning and manifesting himself in a tabernacle on the earth. Excuse me. Tabernacling with his people. But this is what we must study, y'all. We must not only just keep the last six commandments of loving your neighbor as yourself. All right. And you know, that's fine and dandy. That gets you eternal life. But you won't get the kingdom. All right. What does he call those people that got eternal life but didn't get the kingdom? You call them workers of iniquity. Did he? Yeah, he called them workers of iniquity. Matthew 7. 23, I think it is. Let's go there real quick. Go back down. Matthew 7, we'll start at verse 21. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say unto me, that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? In thy name have we not cast out devils? In thy name done many wonderful works. Then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you that work iniquity. All right? So he calls people to get to get eternal life, all right, but didn't get the kingdom, workers of iniquity. All right? Basically, it was sinning against Yahweh the Elohim. Yeah, they got eternal life, because it didn't say they didn't get eternal life. It said they would not get the kingdom. That's what a lot of people in Christianity don't understand. What's the difference between having the kingdom and having eternal life? All right, you can have eternal life and not get the kingdom. Okay. So he calls those that get eternal life, but not the kingdom workers of iniquity. So what's probably most of the way that they were doing iniquity? They were breaking Yahweh's law. They were not worshiping Yahweh the Elohim, the first four commandments of the ten. All right, they were breaking those commandments. They were not keeping a Sabbath day. They were probably, what did it say? Thou shalt have not have any gods before me. They probably certain, you know, worshiping and doing pagan festivals and holidays. That's what a lot of our people do. They, when Christmas time comes around, they write on it. Easter, these are pagan festivals, worshiping false gods. And what does that do? That basically takes them out, that makes them sin against Yahweh the Elohim. All right, now these people can still have eternal life by keeping those last six, like we just mentioned. The rich young ruler said, good master, what a good thing must I do to have eternal life? And he mentioned the last six commandments, and he said, Yahweh said, do that and you will live. All right. He didn't mention the first four. He mentioned the last six. So all you got to do is the last six commandments, and you will have eternal life. But it won't get you the kingdom. All right. But these same people were in the church, because I'm going to show you this. Look at this. Many will say unto me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied? That means they were preaching in thy name. And in thy name cast out devils. They were casting out devils. And in thy name they've done many wonderful works. They didn't say what wonderful works they were doing. They've done many wonderful works. See? I used to think when I, long time ago, I used to think these people went to hell. All right. No, it doesn't mean that. It means that they were not. That's what's the whole topic of this. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom. Let me highlight this. Shall enter the kingdom. Kingdom of heaven. That's a little different than having eternal life. I used to think that people went to hell right there. No, that's not what they're saying. He said, enter in the kingdom of heaven. Let me take you to the scripture. He says, good master. Let me see if I can find that real quick. Because it's going to explain. Let's go down here, 8 verses found. Let's go down here. Matthew 19 and 16. Let's go there real quick. And behold, one came and said unto him, good master, what good thing shall I do that I might have eternal life? What's the topic? Not the kingdom, but guess what? Eternal life. At the kingdom. And he said unto him, what callest thou me good? There's none good but one, that is God. That right there should tell you something right there, saying that only God is good, that he is not God. But if thou wilt enter into the life, keep the commandments. All right. And he said unto him, which commandments? Jesus said, thou shalt do no murder, thou shalt not commit adultery, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not bear false witness, honor thy father and mother, and thou shalt love thy neighbors thyself. Those are the last six commandments. If you look at the 10, you can find them in Deuteronomy and I think Exodus. All right. If you look at those 10 commandments, those are the last six. Which? And those he can say all 10. The young man said unto him, all these things have I kept, mind you, but what lack I yet? Watch this. Jesus said unto him, if thou wilt be perfect, look at this, if you will be perfect, which meaning that keeping those last six is not going to make you perfect. But this will make you perfect. Watch this. Go and sell all that thou hast, give to the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven. Come and follow me. See, you want to be perfect. Because Jesus is going to teach him to do the first four, along with the last six. But when the young man heard that saying, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. Then Jesus said unto his disciples, verily I say unto you, that a rich man shall hardly enter into the kingdom of heaven. So the rich man had eternal life, but guess what? It would be hard for him to enter the kingdom of heaven. Again, I say unto you, it is easy for a camel to go through the eye of a needle and for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. So the kingdom and eternal life is two different things. And you can have eternal life and the kingdom at the same time. You cannot have the kingdom without eternal life. You cannot have eternal life. Let's see. You can have eternal life without the kingdom. You cannot have the kingdom without eternal life. You know, you got to have eternal life. All right? That's the major thing. So don't be deceived, people out there. All right? It's easy to be deceived. And it takes knowledge, to be honest with you. Knowing these things, studying these things, being very sure about these things. Not everybody's meant to be a teacher about it. But to be very sure about these things, even from listening to me, you can have assurance about eternal life and about the kingdom. All right. All right. But this right here is what's keeping our people from being redeemed. Not having the kingdom. What's doing the kingdom? What will get you the kingdom? Worshiping Yahweh Allah. That's not what the nations have taught us. The Christian nations have not taught us to worship Yahweh Allah. Right here, when it says, by doing the will of the Father, what is that? Matthew 7, verse 21. Let me go back there one more time. No one can get the kingdom without doing the will of the Father, right? So what is the will of the Father? Let's go back there. Matthew 7:21 is what we're going to. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven. But he that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. That right there should tell us something. Those first four commandments, worship the Father. Only ones that would get the kingdom of heaven will be the one that doeth the will of the Father, which is in heaven. Which ones? The first four commandments. So that's what Christianity has taught us not to do. That's the reason why the nations get judged in the last day. And they get judged by guess who? This person right here. One that sits on the throne. He's going to cause Babylon to be burned up with fire. Because they misled his people. They misled them and led them astray among the nations with their religion, with their Christianity. All right, everybody. I'm getting a little tired. You know, God bless. And let me say a word of prayer for you. Yahweh, we thank you and we praise you for your word. We ask and pray that it let it be now that your people find Yahweh their Alahayim. The people of Israel find Yahweh their Alahayim. The kingdom is restored unto them. We ask and pray that you bless it to be so now. As Yahweh Shai said, it's given into the Father's hand when the kingdom is going to be restored. We ask and pray that you let it be so now. Restore your people. Get them out of Christianity, out of this false religion. Just only giving them eternal life and not the kingdom. Bless them to get the whole kick and caboodle. By Hashem, Yahweh Shai Mashiach, we pray. Amen. All right, everybody. Gotta let you go. Be blessed.